Charles, it's your Cleveland boys, Tony and Aaron. How are you, buddy?
What's up, guys? Thanks for having me on. How y'all doing?
Thanks for being on. How you doing?
Man, y'all had a damn nail biter last night.
Well,
that was a hell of a game.
Yeah, I thought of you because you're the Jared Allen guy. I know you love Jared Allen. And Chuck, he was a late scratch last night. And I think Cavs fans were pooping a little bit with that game. What do you make of this series and how Orlando is giving the Cavs fits?
Well, it was always going to be a hell of a series. You guys probably wasn't really paying attention to Orlando during the season. You see now, man, they got a ton of talent, They probably, to be honest with you, they probably got more talent than the Cavs. And, you know, they came out and this is not something I said, just saying now, I said on television, they came out in game one and game two and like, oh, this is like a regular season game and y'all punched them in the mouth, but they didn't know how to react. And, Then they went home and, you know, they're like a young team. They played with the crowd and got it going and blah, blah, blah. And then now I think they've settled in. It's going to be a hell of a series, brother. I think it's going seven. I really do.
Yeah, they'll be tough to beat at home. They're a different team at home. Chuck, when
that's because they're young. When you see your family and friends and everybody telling you how cute you look and everything.
Yeah.
So they play like a young team. So when they at home, man, they're a different animal. But like I say, they adjusted. They've kind of woke up in game five. And I think the last couple games are going to be like that.
Mm. Chuck, what do you make of Donovan Mitchell in this series and this year? Cavs have a big decision to make. He's got a big decision to make. What do you think ultimately happens here with him?
That's a great question. I think it's a huge, huge decision. He's a really good player, and he's a really good player. And I think he's a nice kid also.
Yeah.
So you got to make the decision. Man, that's a really tough decision, to be honest with you. I told you, I'd never get on radio or TV and lie. That's a really huge decision for you guys. Like I say, he's a very good player. But yeah, man, that's gotta be a ballsy decision to have to make,
Charles,
for both parties, but for the Cavs mainly.
Yeah, Charles, it's interesting to hear you say, because I say it too. He's a very good player, and some people who are Cavs fans take that as an insult because we're not calling him a superstar. But his playoff performance, you know, here has not been great. Where is he in your mind? Is he a superstar? Is he an all-star? Is he a guy that could be the best player on a team that gets the Cavs back to the finals?
Well, I don't know if he can be your best player because he only impacts the game one way, and that's scoring. When you start talking about superstars, you have to be able to win the game multiple ways. Now, and listen, man, fans are stupid. You know, if you don't tell, you know, when we talk about it during television, he says, you know, fans are idiots. He says they only want two things. Tell me my favorite team is going to win and tell me my favorite player is the best player in the world. That's all fans really want. That's the one thing my boss told me when he says, you're going to be great on TV, but you're always going to get in trouble. And I said, why do you say that? He says, well, you're always going to be honest and straightforward, but that's not what fans want. Fans only want two things. Tell me my team going to win. And tell me my favorite player is the greatest thing since damn bread. And I'm like, well, that's not an insult. When people, like, he's a heck of a player.
Yeah.
But when you start talking about superstars,
yes,
superstars, they can win the game multiple ways. They don't have to score. They can do it with mental toughness. They can do it with rebounding. Or they can do it with assist. There's multiple ways to be a superstar. There's a bunch of guys that are terrific players that can only win the game one way. And Donovan's a hell of a player. If people get offended, they get offended.
Charles Barkley is our guest. So, Charles, the other big series, the Knicks, the 76ers, Knicks kind of blew it last night. They had a shot. Knicks fans, I don't think, are having the parade today. Maybe they'll have it a couple days more. What do you see in that series? And how bad does Embiid look right now, going up and down the court, but still being able to produce and Chuck putting up some big plays when they need him?
Yeah, I wish he would use himself more as a decoy, to be honest with you. What I mean by that is, clearly, and I have no idea why, the Knicks are doubling him every single time. The guy's playing basketball on one leg. If I was Joel Embiid, I would take the double and that hopefully get other guys wide open shots and get going other than Maxey. But, you know, he's just trying to do a little too much. That's why he had 9 turnovers last night. Just use yourself as a decoy. I still have no idea why the Knicks are still doubling him on one leg. He's only going to get 30 points. He got the 51 game, but that was an outlier. I don't know. I'm not sure, but that was a hell of a game last night. The Knicks flat out blew that game. When you were up six with 28 seconds to go, and then you screw around and foul a 3-point shoot, and he makes the three. And then on the next play, you know, Josh Hart missed a free throw. And then, man, we had this argument 365 days a year. I believe you foul every single time. I believe you foul every single time. And I can't believe the Knicks did not foul. And, Tyrone made a hell of a shot, and the rest is history. Now we're going back to Philly. And as I said on the news on TV last night, this is all you New York fans, and this is an old black person reference. I don't know how white people talk about noise. If y'all come down to Philly with all that damn racket, it's going to be some furniture moving, because what they did in games 3 and 4, bringing all those damn New Yorkers down to Philly, was crazy. I had never seen a Philadelphia event have more, in a big games too, have more than outside fans. So I cannot wait for the game tomorrow night. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. Chuck, do you think they're going to rep like that again, or do you think Philly fans are going to say, no, not this time?
Well, you know what's crazy about it? We had Dr. J and Don Staley sent out tweets last night begging fans I mean, it was crazy. We had the great Don Staley and Dr. J sent out tweets talking about don't sell your tickets to New York fans. It was crazy. It was flat out crazy. And, you know, I guarantee you it's great. Can you imagine the dog pound? Because you guys got some of the best fans in the world. Can you imagine some other team taking over the dog pound? That would be crazy, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would. For a playoff game, it would never happen. It did happen, Chuck, when the Browns went 2 years, 1-31. That was not pretty.
And it happened in the baseball when the Cubs won the World Series here. There were 3/4 Cub fans full in the stadium. I guess it's America, and if people can sell the tickets for $1,000 or whatever, they want the money.
Yeah, but you can't do that listen, if you're going to be they would never do that in Boston or New York.
No.
They would never do that in Boston or New York. Boston and New York are two of the best sports towns in the world. Cleveland's one of the best sports teams in the world.
Yep.
I'm shocked that happened with the Cubs, but Cleveland is a great sports city. They wouldn't, and there's only two, like in the NFL, there's only two teams fan base travel. That's the Packers and the Steelers, but they still would, the Brown fans would never give that up.
Hmm. Charles Barkley is our guest. Charles, there's stories out today about NBC wanting to get in on the NBA. I don't know if you've seen this. They want to take the package basically that, you know, is on TNT right now. And as you know, everybody loves your show so much. It's the most popular show in sports, Chuck. It really is. How do you feel about that? And did you guys see this story about NBC?
Yeah, obviously we saw it. And it's a really big deal, obviously. But, you know, I covered my ass, to be honest with you. And I put out an article today with Andrew Marchand in the New York Times.
Yeah.
You know, I just signed a 10-year deal 2 years ago. But one of the things I did, I put an opt-out after a couple years in case, because I wanted to make sure I covered my ass when it comes to this situation. If I wanted to go to Amazon or another, because we thought it was going to be Apple, to be honest with you.
Okay.
So the one thing I did in my new contract, I'm 2 years into a 10-year deal. And when I sit down, I said, wait a minute. Now, if you guys lose the NBA, I want to make sure that I can get out of here.
Right.
And so I am actually in a really great position. And so whether we go to like I say, we knew it was going to be Amazon and Apple, but we didn't know NBC was going to come out the woodwork. Hmm. But the one thing I particularly did in my contract, I put an opt-out clause in there.
Nice.
So I'm not listen, I love TNT, and they've been great to me.
Sure.
But if they lose to NBA, I want to make sure I had all my I's dotted and T's crossed. So something's going to happen. I hope that, TNT, like I said, they've been great to me. But I had to make sure, because this is business, it's nothing personal. As my man Nino Brown said in New Jack City, hey, this is business, it's nothing personal.
Nothing personal.
I want to make sure if we lost the NBA in 2 years, I could be a free agent. So I'm sitting back. Obviously, I'm not worried or paying attention to it, but I'm waiting.
But you would be open, Chuck, to making that move. I'm sure. But Shaq and,
and
Kenny would.
Hell
yeah. Yeah. Hell yeah. You get a new contract, too. I mean, that's always good,
yeah,
too.
Like I say, I want to make sure. The most important thing for me was, if y'all lose to NBA, I want to make sure that I can walk away, no feelings, because, TNT, like I say, they've been great to me. I love working at TNT. But listen, I have to always cover myself. And I made sure that I, because we went back and forth. We went back and forth, me and my agent and TNT. I was like, hey, if y'all lose the NBA now, I want to make sure I can go wherever the hell I want to go. So, like I said, but originally we knew it was going to be Amazon and Apple. And yeah. I want to make sure that I could be a free agent.
Yeah.
Charles, how important is it to you to be able to keep the group together, too? To keep Ernie,
well,
Shaq, Kenny?
It's not that important to me. Number one, me and Ernie are a team. We're gonna leave. We had planned on leaving anyway. We were gonna leave soon anyway, to be honest with you, because Ernie's my guy. Because Ernie wants to retire, and I was leaning toward retiring, to be honest with you. But when Amazon and Apple said they would be interested in the NBA, we clearly had to listen, and. In my conversations with people, I don't know if they want the whole team or not. Because, like I say, I don't think Ernie would go anywhere first and foremost. But I've got to make sure I look out for myself. And so, like I say, I'm sitting back, listening. I'm gonna see what happens. But I don't listen. We're all independent contractors.
Yes, so are we. Chuck,
yes.
Yes, hell yes. I got the same stuff you got in my deal. Absolutely, I can leave anytime. Yes.
Hey, listen, if somebody comes in and offer you a lot of money, you know what you're going to do? You're just going to call some to go. And it's the right thing to do. Because in this business, like, listen, they fired Phil Simms and Boomer Esiason yesterday.
Yep.
And listen, this is business, man. And listen, I love Boomer and Phil Simms. You know, they didn't say, hey, we're going to keep you around. They're like, no, we got young guys coming in. We're kicking y'all to the curb.
Yeah.
So, yeah, of course, we're always going to be loyal, but you have to have common sense also.
Yeah. By the way, Chuck, ES now, as your new agent, I'm just feeling this out. Now we got NBC. You know ESPN would love to have you.
And Amazon.
On their air. And now we got Amazon. So let the bidding war begin, Charles.
I mean, Bezos, right? Like, he could write a blank check.
Let it begin, my friend.
Hey, Aaron, I told you, when the season's over, we got the West this year, so I won't even – if y'all make it to the conference finals, I won't even see you.
Oh.
But when the season's over, you call me. I'm a quick flight over from Philly,
yeah.
And we go play golf. And the only time I answer the phone on the golf course, I don't keep my phone on the golf course. That's just rude. But if I see my agent call, that's the only time I'll call somebody back, because we'll be playing golf somewhere in Cleveland.
All right, you got the it's Tony here, Charles, and you've got my invitation to Canterbury. Remember, you got to play Canterbury. It's where Jack won the PGA.
You.
Yeah, I know, but when we call you, you're so busy. I don't know. I don't want to bother you.
First of all, I'm not busy. I play golf. Listen, I'm an old fat dude. Only thing I do is play golf and fish during the summer. I don't do anything during the summer.
That.
I don't take vacations because I play golf and I fish.
Do you
do that every day
for walleye? You fish for walleye?
You know, I've never fished a walleye.
We'll go take your walleye.
This will be a fun couple days, Chuck. We'll set it up.
Dude, I play golf every single day. The one thing about Philly, we got Marion, Chalkin Valley, we got Aronimink, we got Pine Valley. They're all within 30 minutes of my house.
God.
And so Marion is unbelievable. Pine Valley is, they said, the best golf course in the world. Aronimink is amazing. And I tell you, Marion is crazy. The rough and the greens out there. Then like Chalkin Valley, to me, is my favorite golf course in the world. They got three courses out there. I play golf every single day during the summer. I don't do anything. But listen, the only time I would answer my phone, I see my agent had texted me or called me. That's the only because I'm open for business, brother. I'm open for business.
I love it. Charles, where'd you learn to play golf? Did you learn at Auburn?
No, I never touched a golf club until I was like 23 or 4. Andrew Tony, he was screwing around in the locker room one.
Yeah.
Yes, he was screwing around one day. I said, oh, golf, that's interesting. He said, you ever play golf? I said, dude, I never even touched a golf club in my life. And Andrew Tony took me golfing for that day. I think I was 24 or 25. And now, you know, I got my swing back now. I'm down to single-digit handicap now. I'm kicking ass right now. I'm open for business. Everybody who made fun of me when I had to yip for the last 30 years, I'm looking for them.
Yeah.
But I got my swing back. I'm down to a 9 handicap, and I am balling right now.
Ooh. Chuck, speaking of retirement and bad golf swings, I don't know if you've ever seen LeBron swing a golf club or a baseball bat, but it is not a pretty sight. Mm. Chuck, we were laughing at him yesterday for the way he responded to that question in that press conference. Charles, what do you think he's going to do? Both Riz and I kind of feel like, I mean, what more does he have to prove? He's still good. But at some point, if I was him, I'd want to do other things with my life. Do you think there's a chance he retires?
You know, that's a great question. You know, I was on Shannon Sharpe's podcast last week, and he asked me that question. And what I said was, I hope he retires when he can still play. Because, you know, I saw Michael Jordan with the Wizards. That was not pretty. I saw Patrick Ewing with the Orlando Magic. You know, I hate seeing great players. I mean, I would love to see him play, retire sooner than later, to be honest with you. Because I hate seeing great players. And he's in the conversation. Obviously, I'm a Michael guy. I'm never going to disrespect LeBron because he's amazing. But I would like to see him retire sooner than later because – It ends badly for everybody. If you keep playing, there's going to be a time where Father Time's going to kick your ass. He always going to win. And, you know, and the thing is, I hear these guys on TV talking about, wow, he's playing at such a high, high level. I'm like, he's playing at a high level. Yeah, that's true. He's playing all right. But he's playing with Anthony Davis, and they're in the play-in tournament. So what level is he actually playing at? His numbers are really good. I said, and listen, let's be honest. Anthony Davis had an all NBA year. I got to give that kid credit. You know, I called him street clothes a couple years ago. He played a lot of the season, but like they were in the play-in, and the play-in ain't even a real thing. The play-in is something the NBA made up to get extra money. You know, they're like, hey, instead of having 8 teams in the playoff, let's have like 12 and play like some extra games. I says, oh, that's just a cash grab. And, but I will tell you this, you think about this, LeBron, Steph, and KD all are sitting home after the first round of the playoffs. These young kids, Anthony Edwards, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, Luka, Jason Tatum, the Joker, first of all, it's the Joker's league right now. Let's get that out the way. The Joker is his league right now. We all just living in it. But these young kids between Shai and Anthony and Jason Tatum and Luka, it's their time now.
Yep.
It's starting to be their time. It's the old heads got to get the hell out the way.
Yes.
And let these young guys shine.
Totally agree, Charles. And sometimes I think the league and maybe even the TV networks just hang on too long to the old guys because they still drive the ratings. The only way the new guys are going to drive the ratings is if you guys make a big deal out of them.
Yeah, you know, the thing is, you think about it. I can't even remember how many times we showed OKC with Shai Gilgeous. I don't even have the numbers in front of me. I mean, we show the Lakers and Warriors like they're still contenders. And, you know, everybody got mad at me when I said I took some shots at ESPN like a couple months ago. I said, you know, I'm really sick of you guys talking about every day. Who can make a run? The Lakers or the Warriors?
Yeah.
Who can make a run? They talked about it every day for the last 3 months. I said, neither. They both stink. The Warriors stink and the Lakers stink. And I was so glad the other night. I said, oh, God, the national nightmare is over. It's kind of like the guys. It's kind of like the guys on ESPN who talk about the Cowboys like every single freaking day. I'm like, yo, man, the Cowboys are not. But I was so sick of hearing about, well, who can make a run? They did it like every day for like the last 3 months. Who can make a run? The Lakers or the Warriors? I said, neither one of them. They both stink. And I'm so glad they're both gone. So, Anthony, listen, that boy, Anthony Edwards, he's going to be a problem, man. I haven't seen anybody like him since Kobe and Michael. When, you know, when he said on ESPN, one of my great guys is Scott Van Pelt. When he was on there interviewing me after the game, he said to Scott, he said, you know, and he says, yeah, I'm not worried about anything. I'm just going to kill anything in front of me. And Scott said, what? He says, yeah, Scott, I never won in the playoffs before. I'm just going to kill everything in front of me. Man, it was some of the best TV because I know Michael Jordan well. I knew Kobe well. That was something they would say. I was like, damn, I love this kid. I love this kid. I'm just going to kill everything in front of me. It was just great TV, and I loved it.
Charles, last thing, are you going to make good with Galveston? Are you going to vacation there? Are you going to fish there? Are you just going to let it go?
Man, let me tell you something. If you eat any damn fish out of Galveston, you got some issues because you're going to have some diarrhea, some upset stomach. You're not going to have enough Tums and Pepto-Bismol to make – because, listen, when I went down there, everybody was great. Everybody was great. I want to make that clear. Everybody was great. I went to a karaoke bar. You know, I love doing karaoke. But, man – they tricked me. They told me we were going to have training camp at the beach. When I went down there and all that dirty-ass water was coming on the beach, I was like, you can't go on the beach because the water dirty. Like, everybody's getting mad at me because I said something about Galveston, but you know the one thing they ain't never said? Chuck is lying. That water dirty as hell coming up in Galveston.
Not even the redfish? You're not eating the redfish. The redfish?
Well, you know what you need to ask yourself, why the fish red? It might be some of that oil and dirty ass water turned it red. That fish, like, seriously, that fish wasn't red until it went swimming down in Galveston, and that oil and dirty water made it red.
Charles, here's what I think happens in this series. I think it goes 7, and then I think game 7, both of these teams don't understand the press. I think there's going to be about a total of 25 points scored between the two teams in the first half.
Yeah. Now, Chuck, you were the guy that told us you didn't really believe all that much in Boston. Okay, they lost Porzingis now for a while.
Yeah.
Do you still think they come out of the East?
I do. I think that I still think Boston comes out the East. I think it's right now what I've seen so far. They're going to come out of the East. I think they have the best team in the East. I think the addition of Porzingis and Drew Holiday took them to a whole nother level. Now, you got to be really careful with Porzingis. I think they wrap it up tonight, and he gets maybe 5 or 6 days. Boston's still the team to beat, in my opinion. They're still the team to beat in the East.
Interesting. West.
I tell you what, this Minnesota-Denver series is a big boy game. It's a heavyweight slugfest. I think, I told you, we got the West this year. I think we're going to be flying back and forth to Oklahoma City and Minnesota.
Wow.
That's what I think.
Wow.
Yeah.
Boy, Chuck, that would be something. if they could. I agree with you. I don't think it's the same Denver team as last year, right? You think last year was...
They got rid of all the veteran guys.
Yeah.
They got rid of all the veteran guys.
Yeah.
Their starters are fine, but they got rid of all their guys off the bench. And if you see, the starters have to play fantastic. But what you're going to see in this next series, we never show Minnesota either. I say the thing about OKC, we never show Minnesota either.
Right.
Minnesota has the best depth in the NBA. They've done a fabulous job. There's no deeper team in the NBA than the Minnesota Timberwolves. They have the deepest team. It's still going to come cut down to Carl Anthony Towns.
Yeah. Mm.
I get mad at him because he just wants to stand out there and shoot threes. He's really improved in the last half of the year. He's at the goals in the post. He went in the post against the Suns. If he goes in the post and make them double him or get the other team in foul trouble, they're going to beat Denver. That's going to be a hell of a series. Nobody's going to stop Joker. He's the best basketball player in the world. Mm. But, man, I think their depth, Denver getting rid of, and, you know, it's a salary cap thing, Denver getting rid of all their players on the bench, I think that's going to be the difference.
Interesting. All right, golf. Fishing, we'll do a little gambling too, right? You want to do a little gambling at night? You're in on that.
Oh, hey, listen,
throw
brother.
Some cards.
You know, that's my middle name. That's my middle name, gambling. You know, how Chuck loves to gamble. Hey, let me ask you guys. Hey, can I ask you guys a question?
Yeah.
Were y'all happy with the Browns draft?
Yeah, they didn't have. They had two picks in the top 100. You know, no first round pick, so we were okay with it. It's all on Deshaun Watson. He's got to play well this year. That's what we need, Chuck.
How's his shoulder?
He's fine. He's fine throwing. He's actually out on the practice field today. There should be no setbacks. He should be ready to go. But he's got to, Chuck, he's got to stay healthy. You know these quarterbacks that like to run around, it's hard for them. You know, you got to stay healthy. Browns need him on the field.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting listening to these people on ESPN. They're like, well, it's a new age quarterback and blah, blah, blah. I'm like, well, if you running around, they're going to catch you and you're going to ruin the season.
That's it.
You know, Steve Young had one of the greatest lines ever. He says, yeah, you see a lot of young quarterbacks running around. You know, one thing you never see, old quarterbacks running around. It's a great line, too. It's hilarious and true. It's very true. So, you know what? I want to see Cleveland do well. I think y'all guys are, you know, I love y'all city. It's one of the most underrated cities in the world.
That's so nice.
And when the Browns do good, I hate the Guardians' name. I wish they were still the Indians.
Yeah.
And then the Browns, when y'all do good, man, it's great for sports.
Oh, thanks, Chuck. We love it. This is Charles. I live here my whole life. I worked here pretty much my whole life too. And this is one of the best sports towns in America. I love that you recognize how great a town Cleveland is. Because people have never been here, knock it. You got to come here. You got to actually come here. You'll have fun here.
Dude, it's a great city. Y'all got a great fan base. Great fan base. Not even a good fan base. A great fan base. And it's better when y'all win, man. It's better because y'all fan base, y'all show up and show out.
All right, I'm going to have Aaron text you now. We're going to play this summer.
Count me in, brother. I'm not doing anything. I love
what downtown. Month, Chuck, what month is good for you?
The entire summer. I'm free. Once basketball is over, I'm free until October. I get a 4-month. I'm like a teacher with better pay. That's what my job is. I'm like a teacher. Shout out to all the teachers out there. Remember, love and respect for teachers. But, yeah, I get the entire summer off.
Nice. We'll be in touch.
Charles,
thanks.
Don't be giving Riz any ideas about taking the whole summer off.
I'm all over that. Charles comes to town. I can't work. You guys know that.
He wants your contract. He wants your vacation schedule.
Yeah, I'm all over that. Thanks, Charles. Great stuff, bud. Love you.
Okay, guys. Y'all take care. Be safe. Thank you.
Love you, Charles. Thank you.